Okay, so we continue now with Professor Tatsuya Higaki, who is professor at Osaka University, and he will give a talk on Kuki, Shūzō, and the logic of sense. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for everybody. I understand that the aim of this session, and every presentator speaks about the sensibility, well, Japanese sensibility. So if we have to talk after that, what is the Japanese sensibility? And in my presentation, I would like to compare the philosophy of Kuki and Levi Strauss, and it is two kinds of the logic of sensibility, logic of sense, logic of sense. But I prepared a paper, and this paper is very long. If I read all of the papers, it takes perhaps 50 minutes. So I'm sorry that I can read perhaps only the introduction and conclusion and just a little part of Iki, Kuki, Shūzō's Iki, and the part the register said about the cooking cuisine. Yeah. But introduction and conclusion, I speak following to my English text. I fully understand that the combination of Kuki and Levi Strauss will seem peculiar to readers. This is basically no connection between these two thinkers. It's true that there are some similarities that can only be characterized as happiness, such as the reference to Baudelaire or so. But these are only the results of a shared cultural background. Today, I want to explore the possibility that there is a more fundamental logic that links these two thinkers. The focal point is to discuss discussion will be the term, that structure. Some may say that this is a play of the world. And here, I will not use my counter-argument that the world play was no other than the cookie's fault. Structure is not a notion that Kuki used only in the books of the structure of Iki. He also employed a kind of structural diagram in the most important part of the, his main book, The Problem of Contingency, as well as the genealogy of emotion. It is true that, putting aside the issue of whether the word structure is used, Kitaro Nishida also uses the habit of drawing similar peculiar diagram after his middle period. It is possible that Kuki was influenced by Nishida in this regard. For Kuki, however, the choice of the word structure and the frequent use of diagrams are deeply connected with the content of his argument. Why did he use the word structure? Could the notion somehow be related to the structuralism? That has no relation to Kuki, but flourished to the latter half of the 20th century. Of course, there is no connection between the notion of structure in Kuki's structure of Iki and that of Levi-Strauss, who is said to have been the most rigorous and typical structuralist until the 60s. It need hardly be said that the methodology that Kuki employed in the structure of Iki is German hermeneutics. It is not the structuralism in French. His aim is to use the method of hermeneutics to explicate the structure of consciousness. Again, although Kuki is strongly influenced by the 20th century philosopher that he has direct contact with, such as Bergson and Heidegger, but he is also in one respect, direct heir of the neo-Kantian school, which flourished in the late 19th century and into the 20th century. His table of categories in the problem of contingency is probably a manifestation of this fact. On the other hand, the structuralism of Levi-Strauss is an inquiry into the structure of the unconsciousness, taking as its principle the mathematical structure exemplified in the works of the group of Bruxelles, and Saussurean linguistic structure imported through the works of Roman Jakobson. It is safe to declare that, insofar as the origin of the world structure is concerned, there is no connection between Kuki and Registers. Yet, there seem to be an unmistakable similarity in the way the two thinkers handle the world structure. For example, the following open passage for Kuki's structure of Iki is very suggestive, it seems for me, and I skip the quotation. The concept of, in the quotation, Kuki used many words. The context of ethnic group and language in the first quote, of course, not the same as that of Registros. What Kuki is trying to unravel with his hermeneutic method is the language that, that emerges together with the method of being the ethnic group. It is true that in this approach, we can discern at many levels the influence of German idealism and phenomenology. But insofar as the structuring of Levi-Strauss, he is an ethnologist, is an attempt to elucidate the seemingly irrational phenomenon in various ethnic groups, taking as its subject matter language as well as the family and myth. Then the overlap between the perspective of these two thinkers is indeed clear. Furthermore, the example of French, English, and German in the second quote is the same example given in the very, very elementary structure of a textbook. This cannot be a mere coincidence. The connection don't end there. It is true that the phenomenon that Levi-Strauss tried to elucidate through the notion of structure is first and foremost the structure of kinship groups, in particular the well-known system based on the trading woman. However, Levi-Strauss analyzes ranges across many subjects. Together with Roman Jakobson, he analyzed Charles Baudelaire's poem, The Cat, and later, his interest shifted to the logic of mythology. There are more instances of expression of ethnic meaning via language. Furthermore, we shouldn't forget that during a certain period, one of Levi-Strauss' interests is in cooking, cuisine. Of course, just as mythology was for Levi-Strauss, a mediator between the natural and the cultural order, cooking, cuisine was for him the technique of differentiation of connection between nature and culture. Cooking is a way of connecting natural materials with the human world by leaving the material raw and cooking the material and letting the material rot, and that makes the triangle of the cuisine. This is related to Levi-Strauss' early discussion of language, for language is also a connection between nature and culture. It is at once a differentiation of resonance at the level of natural sounds and the consequent formation of the human being. For Levi-Strauss, both language and cooking are the way of putting human being into the materials taken from the nature. They are human way of registering sensible materials. Return to Kuki. The fundamental concept of, his book was the structure of Iki is, of course, Iki, which is an emotion peculiar to a certain ethnic group. The aim of his inquiry is to examine Iki as both a natural and cultural phenomenon. While the aspect of ethnic meaning is the focus of his inquiry, it also deals with the natural materials such as the body and the sound of language, discerning indeed a logic of human and scientization. Then I skip to the next part, the analysis. Here, it is necessary to keep in mind that the structure propounded by structuralism, whether it be that of Saussure or Levi-Strauss, is not static. Rather, it's a system of bringing with forces. Kuki also uses the term organic. Both Kuki and structuralism share the assumption that the elements don't exist individually, but rather within the kind of tension of opposition of forces. Let us specifically take a look at Kuki's analysis of Iki. As advanced by his use of hiragana character Iki, Iki, he does not simply mean that the Iki, which is denoted by the kanji character Iki, that is to be sick. The word has the very, very much implication. Iki is, in Japanese also, the life, ikiru, ikigaru, arudur, and the breath, Iki. Many, many implications, Iki. It is a world that possesses with itself an extremely dynamic movement and tension, and it is an expression of the emotion. Although it is somewhat well known, let me explain how the concept of Iki is imprinted and understood in the structure of Iki. Let's start from Kuki's explanation of Iki in the chapter The Intentional Structure of Iki. Upon the assumption that Iki is typically seen in the peculiar sensibility involved in the relation between opposite sexes, he presents three elements, coquetry, brave composures, and resignation. We should take notice that all three of these elements express tension with a kind of otherness. While Kuki doesn't present a structured diagram at this point, the content of his argument is also structured. Let's examine the coquetry, and after that, I explained and the coquetry the first, the brave composure the next, and the resignation and the third, and in every phrase, Kuki use just these subjects just as a tension between the two. Two terms. Coquetry is a kind of attraction, and brave composure is a kind of the against each other, and the resignation is we have already finished, and I think that Kuki sees that in the atmosphere of resignation the most high places of Iki, and that is what I explained here. And so I stepped to the last two paragraphs. Thus ran Kuki's analysis. What we should notice is that it is present upon the background of tension as opposition in the diversity of existence. Kuki's discussion here is called the intentional structure of Iki, and what he means by structure is the relationship established between the term and self and the person of the opposite sex. These two terms attract, sort each other away, and remain parallel. But they don't lose their dyadic positioning in this tension. If they were to lose the tension and fall into unity, then Iki would disappear and become anchor. In other words, the relationship between the self and the other would disappear ideally. The self and the other very plainly constitute a structure consisting of minimal terms, and this produces a phenomenon of Iki. And next, the third of the structure of Iki deals with the extensional structure of Iki. Here, the term of the structure go beyond the self and the other and become the element that constitute the sensibility of the Iki. But just as before, what is important here is the structure of opposition, the arrangement of conceptual tension. And after that, I explained this third chapter of Iki no Kōzō, but the most important is this feature, this hexahedron. So I skip the two paragraphs to the and I skip to the middle paragraph of page 5. It is true that Kuki's classification begins with accordance with the Neo-Kantian table of categories. However, his depiction of structure is clearly based on the different principle. For the table of the category is a mere classification grounded in the hierarchical branch of genera and species. On the other hand, while the hexahedron on the cover pages of the Iwanami Shoten, Iki no Kōzō, there is the hexahedron of Kuki. Hexahedron is structural diagram and eighth term at its vertical each corresponds to the classification principle of human generality, opposite sex specularity, towards the and to self. They are established upon the mutually tense horizontal vertical relationship and diagonal relations. No term can exist apart from the tension with the other term. This is nothing other than the structure. The neo-Kantian classification is a mere categorical classification, and it is not a structure. But the reason Kuki used the term structure is because he believes that this kind of tension and relationship is indispensable in the proper account of the matter. And I skip to the next pages, and I skip to the Lévi-Strauss, and I talk just a little on Lévi-Strauss. Let's move to Lévi-Strauss. In his famous essay, The Culinary Triangle Cuisine, Culinary Triangle, Lévi-Strauss developed the toriadic opposition theorem, citing a linguistics of Roma Jacobson. He begins with the following remarks concerning linguistics, and I pass the quotation, some phrases. I read here. The way Lévi-Strauss deals with linguistics here shows that within the sensible possible value called sounds, a language in general can be organized in accordance with the triangle and its variant describable. Sounds are themselves sensible materials of nature, and at the same time, structurally constitute a cultural phenomena. Lévi-Strauss developed his theory by applying these three opposing terms to the three cases of raw, cooked, and rotted in cooking. I have already pointed out that what is that stuff in Lévi-Strauss is the issue of nature and culture. Lévi-Strauss, who emphasized the semiology, defines the raw as that which is unmarked normalke, regard cooked as a cultural deformation and rotted as a natural deformation. Cooking thus checked among the various relationship with this triangle. Lévi-Strauss uses the triangle, and Kuki uses these diagrams. If we read Kuki into the theory, the raw still, if we read Kuki into this theory, the raw will be the coquetry in the relationship, that is the principal element of Kuki, wherein the monistic becomes dualistic and mutually attracting each other. Coquetry is already unnatural, but it is the very material that constitutes Iki, that is the main element of Iki. In contrast, brave composure and resignation can be understood as a kind of deformation of coquetry. Brave composure can be regarded as a deformation due to the natural courses of things, while the resignation can be regarded as a cultural and very individualistic deformation. I talk about the cuisine, the food and the cooking of Lévi-Strauss, and I skip just the latter term, so I skip almost all of the pages of page seven. But I read only one phrase. One phrase. It's the middle of the phrases of the page seven. It seems that Kuki is an excellent practitioner of the structural method that Lévi-Strauss adopted from Jacobson, freely performing the analysis that they envisioned, albeit within the framework of the particular sensibility in the Edo period. And after that, I compare what the Kuki says about the color of Iki and what Lévi-Strauss talks about the some cultural cultural phenomenon, or it taste or so. I would like to compare many things, but there is no time. There is no time here, so that I skip to the conclusion. from world to cosmology. Now there is one more theme that ought to be mentioned in the consideration of the relationship between Lévi-Strauss and Kuki. That is the analysis at the level of the language. Come to think of it, it is not language itself, but cultural cooking of sounds in the nature, between the nature and the culture. And I skip to the I skip to the middle of the page 8. Second part. I skip to the second part. But what we should emphasize here is that when dealing with the poetry and the works of literature, a kind of resonance of play between sound and meaning is crucial within the conceptual structure. I explained the Baudelaire and Romain Jacobson's collaborating works of the Baudelaire's poem. And after that, I said, while language was an archetypical structure for Lévi-Strauss, it was inevitable that he would not be confined to it, but would go to study poetry and play of words and mythology, which is transmitted orally as sound. Kuki shared a certain sensibility with Lévi-Strauss in this respect as well. And it is, I think, the most metaphysical phases between these two people. In this connection, I want to emphasize 2 points. The first point is that Kuki had an extremely sharp appreciation of literature in general, based on the use of the rhythming sounds. This can be seen in his essay, The Theory of Rhythming Sounds. It is true that while his rhythm theory takes up Baudelaire, it does not contain the kind of meticulous and immanent analyzing that can be seen in the work of Jacobson and Lévi-Strauss. Yet, we must take note of the fact that Kuki has conducted a quite systematic and tenacious analysis of poetry and rhythm, very much like a cooking of sound. While his analysis of literary works is, in terms of content, sufficiently contained within the structure of Iki and the generality of emotion, its aspect as a formal theory of the sensibility of sound deeply overlap with the structural project. The other point has to do with Kuki's argument in the metaphysics of literature. If we look at some literature philosophically from the standpoint of temporality, it's the microcosmos, a qualitative time that involves a multi-layered structure. The statement clearly displays the immanent breadth of Kuki's analyzed world. Furthermore, in analyzing the multitude of literary forms, ranging from Japanese and French to classical Chinese, Kuki emphasizes the rhythm and the play of sounds, in particular the double meaning and the refrain in Japanese song waka and haiku and some other modern poems. Next quotation. I skip the next quotation. This suggests that the analysis of sensibility of sound already deeply involved metaphysics itself. Understood at this level, this link with the fact that Lévi-Strauss went beyond to the detailed structure analysis of Jacobson and was led to the cosmological discussion in the mythologies. In this sense, he could say that Kuki was dealing with a post-structural situation that goes beyond the structure. Of course, The cosmological temporality and the cosmological connection is in clear in Lévi-Strauss, in clear in Lévi-Strauss from his early period. But there can be no doubt that structuralism contained from the outset something related to the metaphysical depths. Yet the thought of Kuki, who conducted the analysis of literary forms, was particularly concerned with the form and the structure, and extended the inquiry into the eternal now, eien no ima, clearly Nishijian metaphysical notions. Kuki's thought, as well as his concept of structure in Structure of Iki, is not merely the classically and static, but rather concretely exhibit itself through its structural formalism through the structural formalism as opening the path towards an extremely dynamic metaphysical discussion. This direction immediately overlaps with the Lévi-Strauss development of theory of mythology. Here, the structural theory of sensibility of these two thinkers should be understood as being ultimately intertwined. As to whether this is an inevitable consequence of the age of the 20th century, or in which the two man lives, or it is just a quick of fate, there is perhaps no clear answer. Thank you very much. Sorry.
You are welcome. Thank you to shorter the text. The discussion is open. We don't have a lot of time, but time for some questions. Yes?
I'm very happy with your presentation, because I'm also working with Kuki and also working with the rhyme. Yes, literature in Kuki.
Yeah.
And my question, it's more a commentary.
Yeah.
Because there is this article, it's very old. Mm. That is Gengo Toshite no Kuki Tetsugaku.
Gengo Tetsugaku. Yeah.
And he talks something very near what you talk, but relating Kuki to Jacobson and semiology.
Yeah,
semiology. And my question is that if you think that Kuki taught about language, like an structure, or has play. So in his technology, if language is near necessity or near contingency.
That's a question. I think that about Kuki did not make a book on literature. He wrote some of the essays, but only some of the essays on literature. But in this literature, he speaks very much about the rhythmic poem. Is very important to think about the contingency and to think about the iki, to think about what is our life. And I think that it is a very important thing. And I would like to notice that in one essay, he says that in some kind of Japanese poem, there is a repetition. Difference and repetition. Of course, it is a rhythm and ritornello. It's a rhythm and ritornello. So he sees that in the some rhythm of the poem, the eternal na. It is the Nishidian word, Nishida's word, eternal, eien no ima. And he sees that eien no ima, just in the structure of the poemic language that repeat many times, and that has sound, the sound resonance is very important, the meaning itself. And I think that this sensibility of Kuki is very important and very metaphysic, and I think that it is very much important to explore. More difference.
Thank you.
Okay, if there is no other question or remark, yes?
I don't know much about Kuki, but I'm interested in when he deals with poetry, does he also, for example, deal with Japanese renga?
Renga, Japanese renga, yeah.
Because I think it's also pretty interesting for the problem of repetition. Mm. Because there is this kind of middle phrase which one poet uses it as an end for his poem, and then the next one uses it as a beginning.
Renga is some other person's...
I forgot the word, but this kind of usage of repetition which comes... same phrase comes in both poems, and both authors work together, and they kind of have this dialogue.
Yeah.
I think this would be really interesting for the problem of repetition and...
I understand, but I want to ask Oda-kun. Perhaps Kuki, he don't speak about the renga. Perhaps he didn't analyze the renga. He analyzed some kind of the modern poems that have some repetition, or the waka or haiku. And that has very much the resonance of the sound. That's important. But I think that waka is a kind of dialogue between two persons and many persons, and that the repetition continues.
Because for me, I think this is kind of closer to the kind of Japanese repetition, because in classical Japanese poetry, there's not really rhyme, right? It's not rhyme in the sense of European poetry. So I find it interesting that he concentrates on rhyme. But we heard in the other talk already about this. It was also about rhyme, so there's interesting correlation.
Okay, thank you very much, and for all these very inspiring talks.
Yeah.